All right, everybody. Willie the Bam Johnson here with Fuya Magazine, from the underground to the mainstream. We got one of my heroes, my main man, Mr. Michael Jai White. You know, I always talk to y'all about him. I mean, he done had a great success with Black Dynamite out there right now. I know everybody then heard about it, then seen it written up in all the magazines, so forth, giving it great ratings, bringing it right back to how the martial arts used to be back in the 70s. Mr. Mike, tell him, I mean, what was it like working on Black Dynamite?
Well, I mean, it was a labor of love because, I mean, I wrote the movie. You know, got it produced and, you know, starred in it clearly. And so, I mean, it was a lot of fun, man, because, I hired my friends, and you know, that genre meant so much to me. I know it has been as well. And, you know, it was a genre that, you know, we take great pride in, because it finally showed African Americans in a fashion that was, that was worthy. You know, worthy fashion. It was not, we weren't servants and maids and all that type of stuff. We were the heroes, and, you know. We had strong alpha males as role models. And so, you know, I wanted to pay homage to that, you know, that alpha male that I grew up, you know, trying to be.
He's super bad. He's out of sight. He's Black Dynamite.
House cuts when you please.
Yeah.
Dynamite, baby, Nipsey still ain't paid up.
Solid. I'm on it, B.
This time is on sight. He's killing who we want to. So you know he's dynamite.
He's dynamite.
Who's that?
I'm looking for Nipsey.
There's no Nipsey here.
Now I'm gonna ask you one more time. Where's Nipsey?
Here I am, sucker!
And coming from a kung fu movie and walking through New York and feeling the vibe of the street and I know you made the nunchakus and all that stuff. What was that culture like? I mean, even being a part of a dojo. I mean, because people look, it's like, some reason they look like, they think that life never existed, where there was no dojos in the inner city. There was no good instructors in the inner city. What was that culture like for you?
Well, see, one thing is, I explained to a lot of people that the martial arts came by way of the inner city.
Okay.
I mean, it came, you know, from the Orient.
Yes, sir.
And it was, you know, came to this country by way of GIs, you know, soldiers who were in the Orient, in Korea, Okinawa, Japan, who learned the art and brought it back here, right? And so where did they teach it? Not in the suburbs. They taught it in the ghettos. You couldn't teach true martial arts anywhere else. It wasn't a business. It's a business now. You know what I mean? It wasn't a business back in the day. And we grew up seeing ghetto martial art warriors. Because, I mean, literally, you could not have a business in the suburbs. You can't teach martial arts the way it was taught back then in Beverly Hills. No, you had to go to the projects, and every great instructor, whether it be, you know, the pioneers, the Peter Urbans, you know, that's why he taught people who that was, you know, straight up ghetto, and that was the, you know, it appealed to the real fighter, the real downtrodden, because it was developed for downtrodden people who had to fight against oppression. So, you know, you ain't gonna teach that wasn't talking to rich folks.
And we're so wild. I mean, I think the one thing that I get, even in one of your interviews when you talked about after a sparring class, you had to get a bruise, you had to get a busted lip or a fractured rib, because you didn't learn anything. But not just did that injury to me, not just did that injury like make you come back so you wouldn't get hit in the rib again the next time, you might get hit in the eye the next time. But the thing it was building was character.
Oh, absolutely.
That made us be stronger, the men that we are today.
Absolutely.
I mean, would you agree?
Well, absolutely. It's I mean, there's so much. I mean, we understand the business of it and the evolution of it. But when you had to train your knuckles, when you got hit by people with trained knuckles, you know, some serious intestinal fortitude. It wasn't no cakewalk, you know. So you've had some teeth knocked out, and that was just par for the course. You didn't, at the time, you didn't have nothing else to compare it to. I remember the advent of wearing pads. It was so foreign. Who's this to protect?
Well,
I condition my knuckles and my knees and my shins on a macchiato board for a reason. You know what I mean? So when you had, you know, people taping up and then covering up in pads and stuff like that whole element changed. You know, it's almost like you fighting a war with BB guns. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I know.
So, you know, of course, that changed a whole lot in the fighting and the you know, the whole spirit. You know, and then almost everybody can get that black belt.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You didn't run into that wall, that thing that says, well, "Why am I doing this?" And have to overcome. You know, walk through that fire. And forge yourself beyond. You know what we really knew. But that was such a gift to us.
Yeah.
That was such a gift to us, because nothing compares to that.